I get to interview a lot of people, and they all have their own opinions on what the most dangerous invasive species is to our local waterways. But I want to hear from you guys. For the next couple of weeks, there's going to be a poll up on my YouTube channel. You can pick from the snakehead, the blue catfish, the flathead catfish, the grass carp, or the Alabama bass. If none of these are what you consider the most dangerous for our local waterways, just comment down below in the comment section, and I'll put that on my spreadsheet. Again, this poll is going to be up for the next couple of weeks. Please go vote. It really would help me just try to figure out where people stand and what they think the most threatening thing is to our waterways.
You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your hosts, Thomas Ahrens and Jared Mounts. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.
You see that thing back behind my right shoulder? See that box right there?
The black box on the wall?
Yeah, it would be blue if you saw it in person. That's an old police call box. So back in the early, before like 1975, if you walked the beat in Washington, D.C., and you made an arrest or you needed an assistance, you had to walk over to one of those police call boxes, open them up, and contact the station and say, send me help or send me the wagon. I got one.
So was that when things were black and white too, and you had to like have a little knob that you roll?
Yeah, basically, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, that's not even that long ago, man, that they switched over to handheld radios, if you think about it.
Why, though? Why did they wait so long to do that?
I don't know. Well, you should have seen the beginning, the handheld radios they used to have at the start. They're like giant bricks. Awful. They were so big.
Wait, like nowadays, and I don't know shit, but like you have that little handheld thing on like your nipple right here that you talk into.
Yeah, I never liked the mic, but go ahead. Yeah.
But like before that, did you have it on you or did you keep it in the vehicle?
No, you have it on your belt. All the policemen have them on their belt.
So even when they were big bricks in the 70s, you still kept them
with
you?
Yeah, they did. They sure did. Yeah.
Crap, that sucks.
Yeah, I mean they were as big as this thing, man, back in the day.
Jeez.
Yeah, well, you know, they doubled up as self-defense weapons as well at times.
You just beat them with your phone.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the old the Nokias, which basically were bulletproof. You could throw them at somebody, skip them across a lake, and they would still work.
Yeah. You remember that service that the cell phones used to have where did you ever have a phone like this where you could just key it up, put it to someone's number, key it up and like talk to them like a walkie talkie, be like, hey,
yes,
man, you
know?
Like,
yes,
out of nowhere, they could be sleeping. You'd be like, hey, wake up.
It was like the only phone made for like contractors. Like I remember when I used to do landscaping, I had people that had
push to talk. It was called.
Yeah. That's a fun feature to get back. Yeah. That's the thing, though, is everything nowadays is built so dainty as shit, and it's like it's built to break. Where I'm not even a boomer, but it's like back in the day, things were built better. Nowadays, everything feels like it's just flimsy.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you have your cell phone, like one of these iPhones in your pocket, and you have like bulky clothes on, and it's in a spot when you bend over, you could bust that thing in half, man. You could break the screen on it.
I've sat on my phone like twice. Once I cracked the screen, I'm not that fat. I mean, they're just not built like they used to. And that's even in like the fishing industry. Some things now, it just feels like they're flimsy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like fiberglass boats, things like that. What did he say?
What did you say?
I was just saying like some of the, even the lure quality has gone. If you look back at some of the stuff in the 80s, some of the stuff that was made of metal is now made of plastic. So it's real lightweight and it doesn't even work the way it's supposed to.
Yeah. Well, and then a lot of people don't use balsa wood either. Balsa wood doesn't crack, you know?
Well, so I think there's two parts to that. It's like, one is everything's built to fail because you make more money. And two, I think it's not built as strong either. Cause like no one wants durability. No one wants anything to last long, which sucks because I think you see that completely in plastic. Oh crap. Let me show you. I got this from a guy that we had on the show. He doesn't make these things to fish with, which is so crazy. You can. His name is, before I give it out, Jack Krause. He's a woodmaker.
Oh, that's cool, man.
That's nice looking.
It's a handmade from cherry oak. He makes it from different wood. It takes him like a day to make just one of these baits.
Uh-huh.
Holy moly.
And then it's just absolutely crazy. but he'll make whatever you want in whatever type of wood you want.
That's awesome.
But he'll make it custom. But my point with this is, like, people don't make shit like this anymore.
No.
And that's what's so sad is, like, something like this would probably smoke them now, or something made with that kind of care. But nowadays, it's such an assembly line thing. It's so hard to get good quality products unless you custom make them.
That's the kind of bait, if you get it snagged on something, you're jumping in the water.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We had a guy there. I didn't interview him, but we just talked to him. He actually made a trout bait. It was a custom wood bait, like a I think it's called ramen. It cost him like $600 to get it made. And I was just thinking to myself, like, there's no way in hell you're throwing that balls of the wall into a dock or a tree or something like that. No way you got the balls to do that.
Maybe a swimming pool filled with fish.
Maybe a swimming pool.
Hey, could you imagine the polar plunges you'd take to get that thing in cold water?
Ooh. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. 100%. It's like why, like, with eBay, like the original wiggle warts and things like that. Like, if you spend $200 on eBay, like, where are you going to throw that thing? Because let's say you could absolutely just light them up with it. If you get that thing snagged, you're going to be in a world of hurt.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I'm calling Progressive. Get that thing insured.
Yeah, you'd have to insure it. You'd want to insure it, man.
Has there ever been a bait like that either of you have owned where it's like you were going to get that back come hella high water?
Yeah. They're not that expensive, but I have these right here because I was going to talk about jerk baits, but these mega bass lures, man. I'll go and get those.
Wow.
Because, you know, they cost between $20 and $25. The Whopper Plopper. I got my eye on one that's in a tree that got put there this summer. I got to go over. It's over near, I don't want to give the location up, but it's near White's Ferry.
But the better story is the way you stated that is like it's been there for a while. Like you pass it like a neighbor. Why haven't you gotten it yet?
Because it's high in the tree. I'm waiting for the water level. So it's in reverse. It's not where I need to jump in the water. I need the water to come up to like flood stage. I'm going to go out there and get a $12 lure.
Because I feel the same way about the dishes in the sink. It's like, well, if I leave it, maybe my wife will get it. It kind of sounds like that.
I'm sure she really likes that too, huh?
Yeah. No, she's thrilled with it. That's why I'm down here right now.
Yeah.
So how has the fishing been? That's a hell of a segue, but how has the fishing been on the river past month or two?
Good. It's been good. I mean, there's slow days. And then there's the other day I was out and it was pretty good, the fishing, you know, there's days where I go out and we only catch a couple fish. Some days we go out and we catch, you know, close to 10 fish in this real cold water. About a week and a half ago, I was out there. Of course, it was just me. You know, I'm out there fishing and just looking for fish. I caught one that was 21 inches long.
Nice.
Fish over 5 pounds.
Nice, dude. Wow. Yeah.
Caught it on a 4-inch swim bait.
There you go. Swim bait, bring them back.
Yeah. Well, I'm fishing it on the bottom like a tube. So, you know, just bouncing it on the bottom. You throw it in. I mean, the water was what, 39 degrees. Throw it in this first, I pull up to this eddy. It's in the middle of the river because the water's low right now. I pull up to this eddy and I'm throwing a jerk bait, you know, a Lucky Crap, a pointer 78. And I catch a fish in this little eddy. And, you know, of course, I go to throw in there a couple more times. Nothing hits, right? So I switch over to a plastic bait, and that's when that 21-inch fish hit.
Oh, that's freaking awesome, dude. That's freaking awesome. What has the water temperature been like? Because it's been pretty bipolar, the weather lately.
Yeah, it's been in the high 30s, from 37 to about 40 degrees.
Okay.
But you know, that was the fourth citation fish, this year so far.
Really?
Yeah. On my boat.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, that river, puts out some big fish.
What are your thoughts for this coming spring? When does the bite start really segueing from the winter time to like the early spring for you? What are you looking for?
Sometimes like the third week of March. It's going to get real, it's going to pick up. It always does. It picks up the third, fourth week of March. And then, you start, thinking that's pre-spawn, you know, early pre-spawn. I mean, just these real big smallmouth just come out of nowhere. And I tell you what, I catch a lot of them on jerk baits late March. Yeah, you know, the water's going to, there's more daylight. The water's warming up no matter what, you know. It's just going to get warmer. And you'll still get those high 30s, like 38, 39 degrees. But by the end of the day, you'll see temperatures like 40, 41 degrees. And then as March goes on, it just keeps getting, you know, warmer and warmer and warmer.
What specifically about March and that time period are you looking for? Because, like, we could always say, is it like, let me rephrase it. Is it always like that mid-March time, or are you looking for like just the water temperatures and the clarity to get where they need to be?
You're getting close to spring. The water level starts coming up too. You got that real high water level and high enough to push the fish under the shorelines. You tend to have really good days.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. So it's about coming up too. Gotcha.
Yeah. And then, you know, if the water level comes up, from what I've noticed, the water level comes up and then it sustains itself. And let's say it creeps up at Edwards Ferry gauge. Because if I told you 6 feet and someone's watching us at the, if I said 6 feet, they'll think, well, that's super high because they're thinking the Point of Rocks. But Edwards Ferry gauge, if it goes up to about 6 feet and then it just levels out and stays there for several days, the fish will be in those same spots over and over and over again until the water falls or rises again.
Gotcha.
They just seem to start being more consistent. March is a month where you start catching them and the fishing becomes more consistent. The fish start becoming a lot more easier to, dictate where they're going to be.
Are they still in those same holes in March, or are they starting to move, like you said?
No, they're in eddies and stuff like that.
Okay, gotcha.
And you know, they're more, and they just seem more willing to bite.
I don't know. That one day we had, it's been a little while now, but still, like, I was impressed with that fishery. I know you weren't thrilled with how many we caught, but what was so much fun about that time was, like, everyone you stuck was a pig.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, besides the one dink that somehow, I guess I snagged the damn thing with the blade bait, everyone was an absolute pig.
Yeah, I'm telling you, man, I don't know what it is, but the Potomac and the Shenandoah just, of course, the Shenandoah is a tributary, so that helps because they're swimming on both rivers. But there's some big fish, man.
Oh, there's some monster ones. Oh, I got to bring this photo up. Keep talking about what you're talking about while I bring this photo up. But yeah, it's – and that was interesting too. Like, do you think – like, which river do you think is going to give up a trophy-sized walleye first? Do you think it's going to be the Shenandoah, or do you think it's going to be the Potomac?
I think it'll be the Potomac because it's a bigger river system. And that's my only answer to you on that one. It's just a bigger river system, obviously. So I think it's going to have a big walleye in it. The biggest I've seen is 25 inches.
I think there's a 25. I think there's a 30 incher in there, definitely.
And that one was caught on a spinnerbait.
Dude, those walleye are weird because I'm trying to figure out how you like pinpoint those suckers into what they like. But I really need to re-educate myself on walleye fishing because they are different.
You know, I don't I only catch them bass fishing, you know. I don't target them or anything. I do know if you catch them in one spot, they're usually there's usually maybe a couple more hanging out together. They're pretty they like to group up. I guess you can call them schooling fish, but this past spring, I had a trip where we caught five of them bass fishing.
Really?
Just in the same locations that we're looking for smallmouth. Yeah.
Wow.
Hitting. They love. I'll tell you what they like in the spring. They love spinner baits and they like chatter baits and jerk baits.
They like movement.
Yeah.
They absolutely love movement, and there's a lot of them. Like, it's weird, like, how with stuff like this, like, it hits, like, a critical mass point where, like, you see one or two of them, and then the next year you go out and they're everywhere. And I feel like with the walleye population, it's getting there. Or it could be that I'm just so in tune with this now with the podcast, and I'm inundated with so much fishing stuff that I'm just seeing them more. But I really think it's because there's just more of a population than there was.
Well, you could probably go out and just target them. I mean, there's so many on the Upper Potomac River and probably in the Shenandoah that you could just target them if you knew what you were doing.
Oh, easily.
And you know that they spawn sometime in late February, early March, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's how cold of a fish they are. They love cold water. They thrive in that real cold water.
And they eat good. And there's a lot of them. And again, I think we talked about this. And we've talked about this a bunch of times. But like the more species that there are like that, the more opportunities there are for you as a guide to go out mm-hmm. there and you know, book trips, whether it's big flathead now that they're in there, mm-hmm. walleye, smallmouth, but hey, snakeheads. You know, like if yeah. those things get really thick in there, you're gonna be able to retire with that mansion if the snakehead.
That those snakeheads would be cool to see if you could see them every so often. You know, bass fishing, mm-hmm. but I haven't seen any on the Upper Potomac yet. People say they've caught them, but I haven't seen one yet.
Really?
Yeah.
I keep hearing the rumor, and I heard allegedly that there was one caught at the Big Slack.
Dam 4, you mean?
Yeah, Dam 4. I think it's Big Slack. Yeah. But I don't know. Like, again, I just think like their populations right now are where the walleye were like 4 or 5 years ago. Like, they're just not there thick enough yet to where you're going to constantly see them.
I don't know if they like current, man. I don't know if you're really going to catch them out in like the main section of the river. I don't know if it would be a thing to catch them in eddies, shoreline eddies. I don't really know how they operate. I mean, I know they go up in the creeks and stuff, and they like slack water and, you know, just nasty, stagnant water. And Upper Potomac really doesn't offer that.
And that's why if you're going to catch, I think it's going to be going down south towards the falls. Like that's where I think it's where you get that slack water.
I don't know if they're real strong swimmers. I have no idea. I don't know if they can go up, you know, through like smallmouth can go up through Harper's Ferry all mm-hmm. the way up through there and go up towards, you know, Shepherdstown and stuff. They can cut up through there. I don't know if snakeheads can swim in that real swift water. I don't know what they're about, you know?
That's something I need to ask Odenkirk when I get him back on the show. That'd be a very good question to ask about what their populations will do and how they'll advance. But I did get this photo up. And I want to show you this because this will lead into my next question. I want to show you what an absolute donkey looks like. So this right here. And you might have heard about this. This is the Dirty 30 that just got caught out of Lake Anna, 30 pounds.
Jeez. Wow. And on the public or private side?
This is public. It was at the last Elite Series, Lake Anna Elite Series. Dirty 30. Absolutely insane. And also, guys, just to let you know when this airs, I did call this on my last interview with, I think his name is Tyler. He lives at Lake Anna. I said, I think the Dirty 30 is going to come out of there sooner rather than later because this is not even the F1 strain. But anyway,
I was going to say real quick, I mean, it's cold. It's obviously wintertime, and that's another point to add to that is that's why they're catching such big largemouth.
Oh, yeah, 100%. But like, damn, dude, a 30-pound sack in Virginia?
Yeah, that's pretty good, huh?
It's freaking insane. Now, when are you going to see a 25-pound sack of smallmouth coming out of the Upper Potomac?
I don't know. Let's see.
Do you think it's even physically possible for that to happen?
Yeah, what's that? I mean, that's – I would imagine it is. I mean
– I got a calculator. Hold on. We'll figure it out.
In one day, I've caught more than one 20-inch fish, bigger than 20 inches, you know?
So that means it's got to be a 5-pound average, roughly, for 25, 26.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure it's possible.
Because there was that big tournament.
At the right time.
Because there was that big tournament in Brunswick last year, right? And there was some good sacks taken out of there.
That happens, I believe, every spring or early spring.
Yeah.
And I think Department of Natural Resource does it to collect fish to spawn so they can release, some more smallmouth back into the river.
No, that's 100% true because I remember we interviewed that guy, and because I am just absolute shit with names, let me give me 5 seconds here and I will get you his name because yes, that is a thing. His name was John Mulliken. John Mulliken is the head DNR for the Upper Potomac. You got to get your vote from him.
They're going to still do that program, I believe.
I think they are. And I thought what was interesting about that is I think there was multiple 20-pound bags taken out of that tournament.
Yeah.
But I really think the way the Upper Potomac is fishing right now, again, like I didn't grow up fishing in hardcore, but I do remember there was a time in there when the Upper Potomac was shit. And when we went out there together, I'm telling you, it's just like, it's the truth. Now, Grant, let me say this. The Upper Potomac, when it went down into its trough, it was nowhere near as bad as the Shenandoah. I'm saying like it had a lull, but it wasn't like Shenandoah where like 70% of the population was just dead. But when we went out there together, it was like, good Lord, there are some pigs in this place again. It's really nice. And it's just, it blows my mind every time because it's like, it's so close to Ashburn and Leesburg and all these big areas. And when you and I went out there, besides that one weird duck hunter that might've been doing meth, don't know that 100%.
Oh, you were with me with that guy.
Yeah.
Hey, if he's watching us, hey, how you doing, buddy? He's probably watching it right now. He's like, I'm going to get those two.
He's going to get you before he gets me.
Oh my gosh. Remember that guy was, he kept asking me where the Monocacy is. And I told him, and he's like, well, I went down there, but then he reveals that he didn't even go down far enough. I'm like, well, you can't miss it. It's on the left-hand side if you go down the river.
And then he was asking where our guns were.
Oh yeah. He was asking us where our guns were. And he could clearly see there's a bunch of fishing poles on the boat.
Yeah, I don't think it was completely there mentally. I don't know. Have you talked to him since?
No, I haven't seen him. I've gone up that way.
But not at all, really?
Yeah, no, I've stayed. I've either gone up above that to lander, or I've just fished down below it.
Gotcha. Okay, that makes sense.
I mean, if the water's higher, I feel like you can go up there and you can probably find some fish up there. That's real shallow up there, man.
Yeah, like that section right in there, it's really, I think it's a good summertime place, especially if you're up float.
Sure.
But yeah, I mean, there are some really good holes in there as well. And that's like, have you seen the fish stacking up right now in the wintertime in any of those deep holes like they used to?
Yeah, I was in a hole recently and there was 10 fish in it.
That's crazy.
And I missed two. So there's maybe 12 fish in it. So, yeah, that was one of the holes where there was a 20-inch fish in
that you stuck.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, with that being said, is it because of the temperatures? Is that why the fish starting to stack up now? Is there a specific temperature you're looking for? Like when it hits like 30 degrees and it gets colder, does that actually turn the bite on or does it just dense them up?
Well, no, it's going to put them in. It's going to put them in eddies and spots where they can get out of that cold water, so to speak. Okay. You know, yeah. So yeah, it can cause them to concentrate more in certain areas. But you know, the colder the water gets, the possibility of catching them goes down because they just don't want to move. There, you know, you might have to just, you know, if you're in like 35, 36 degree water, your lure is probably going to have to just bounce right in front of their face and then they'll suck it in, you know, like they can stay pretty far away. I've maybe a foot or so, and wow, pull those baits in that, you know, a big fish can flare its gills, you know, and suck it in.
Wow. Wow.
So, that's that tap you feel in the wintertime. That's what I believe is when they, when you're fishing and they come up and they suck it in, you know, they suck it in real hard and you feel that initial tap. And then you have a few seconds for it to register in your head that was a bite because they're getting ready to throw it, you know?
I also think like, that's why in the wintertime you have to set the hook more. You gotta be a little bit more trigger happy because that bite is so freaking light. Where I remember that one I stuck with you, it felt like I just had like mush or a leaf on it, like on the end of my line, until I got a little bit closer to the boat. And then I had to, you know, I had to hit him again to make sure I got the hook buried in him. But I think so many people, when they go out in the wintertime, they just, they pull the bait right out of their mouth. Cause they mentally, their head doesn't go first. So like, it might be a bite, set the hook. Their mind goes straight to like, it's probably just junk on the end of my line. I don't want to get snagged. You have to be willing to get snagged and just just when in doubt, just let them, let's let it eat and whack them.
Yeah. They, it's amazing that you'll feel that tap. You'll feel a very distinct tap. Like someone's down there and they're pulling on your line, you know? And then sometimes you won't feel anything. And I think that's when they just pick it up. They actually come over and actually mouth it and pick it up. And you can't feel that, but you can feel them suck it in. But if they come up and just and mouth it and pick it up, and they're just holding on to it. And that's why you have to check your line every so often when you're fishing. You want to lift up some. And then once you start feeling that that weight on the end of the line, like you just said, you want to set the hook. You don't even want to reel down on them at that point. Once you start lifting up and you feel that weight, wherever you are at that moment in time, that's where your hook set should be, you know?
And personally, that's where it comes down for me. Like if I'm bottom bumping and stuff like that, I'm going to go with a little bit heavier tackle. This is personal preference, guys, because that way I can set the hook and I don't care. I'll just bring the damn treat with me. Like, I don't know. Like it feels weird when you use 6 pound test, because then you're like mentally, I'm like, oh, I don't want to set the hook into this, because if it is a log, I'm going to lose this bait, or it's going to be a pain in the ass getting it back. But if you got 14, 15 pound test, you're like, screw it. Whack. You don't care. You just bring the whole thing, in with you.
Yeah. Well, yeah. No, there's nothing wrong with heavier line. There's a lot of people that use like 10, 12, four, like you just said, 14 pound test line.
Yeah. Cause again, guys, like, I'm not saying like you're not using 25 pound floor or something. I'm just saying like you're just going above a little bit more to where you have a little bit more abrasion resistance. Mm-hmm. And I think it gets the job done. The other thing I thought that was interesting I wanted to bring up was a technique that you and, oh my God, I'm having an elderly moment. Who the hell was his name? Chris Gorsuch. Cause like, yeah, that's an easy name to forget. Talking about dead sticking a jerkbait. That is that's a fascinating thing. How the heck did you guys come up with that?
Well, I've learned it over the years from, people before me, but, yeah, I mean, it's a known fact. You throw that bait out, pop it a couple of times to where you feel like you've gotten it down to like this bait right here, these Lucky Craft 78s right here. I don't know. Can you see it okay?
Yes, I can. Wow.
Yeah. And does it tell you on the back what it is? Well, anyways, it says right here. It says a pointer 78. You probably can't see it real well. See, pointer 78. So you take this and you pop it a few times to get it down to whatever its level you think it's supposed to go down to, I don't know, 4 feet, something like that. It'll suspend, maybe 5. I guess depending on the water temperature will let that thing suspend shallower or deeper, depending on what the water temperature is. And you throw it out and you just leave it and you fish it like bait.
And then
what you feel is you'll feel them tap it. You'll either feel them tap it or you'll go to reel a little bit just to move it just a hair, and it doesn't go anywhere. And then that's when you know there's a fish on it.
So is it basically trolling? Are you getting above the target and then you're casting downstream? Or are you just like fly fishing where you're casting up current and you're letting it just drift through?
Well, you can even just dead stick it in an eddy. But yeah, so you'd pull up to a spot that you fish with real slow moving water in the wintertime. You know, this spot that you're fishing, there's an eddy there, there's a current break, and the water is slower. There's still water, and then there's some real slow water, and then you have the rest of the river that's just rolling, you know? And you throw it in there and you pop it a few times and just let the current handle it. Let it take it all the way back behind the boat.
Okay.
I mean, you can leave it out there for several minutes before they hit it.
When do you opt to go with that technique in this time of year? Because that seems like, to me, it's boring as hell.
It is. And you just have to try it from day to day and see if it works. I've been catching fish like that.
It 100% works. It blew my mind.
I've been catching fish, but some days you'll catch more on the jerkbait than others. There'll be some days where you never even have to change up your bait and you can just fish a jerkbait the entire time. It's difficult to do, man. I mean, you got to throw it out there and basically put your hands in your pockets and let it just sit.
Yeah,
but, it's going to come up and whack it. When they hit it, you're going to feel it.
It's a really cool technique that I want to kind of practice with. To me, it feels like that's what spy baiting was before spy baiting. You know, that's something I blew Travis's mind out of the water when I went fishing with him. And he was literally doing the same technique you're talking about. We used dead sticking it. And I told him, like, I have too much ADHD and caffeine. So I picked up a spy bait and I started to have some success with it. And I really always thought mentally, like, maybe that's what the dead sticking jerk bait basically does, is it gives you that know nothing action that the fish really want.
Yeah, no, they're attracted to it. They like hitting those things when they're dead sticked in the water.
How do you dictate your retrieve cadence at this time of year? Besides taking like propofol or Xanax and just like one twitch, 5 minutes, two twitches, like how do you slow down like that?
Water temperature this time of year, I'd like to go out and if there's areas where I'm real confident that there's going to be fish, throw it out and pop it one time, let it sit for 10, 20 seconds, pop it again, let it sit for 10, 20 seconds, pop it again. And then as the water warms up in the mid 40s, pop it a couple of times, let it sit. It just depends on where you're getting bit and that cadence of how you're bringing it back to the boat.
Gotcha. That makes a lot of sense. So, Jeff. Hi.
What's up, Tom?
So how did you two crazy kids meet?
I met Jeff, 3 years now?
Yeah.
About 3 years ago. He was looking for somebody to do some repair work on his boat. And I believe he had taken it to some other place and really wasn't satisfied with some of the work they had wanted done. And some of it was pretty extensive. We put a major brace in the front of his boat. Mm-hmm. I think it was one of the first things we did where the eye hook is up front on the bow needed some big reinforcement. So we put a big piece of 3/8 aluminum inside. We got inside the console up front where some of the gauges are at, opened that up, cut a piece out, bent it, and welded that in there. And I don't think he's had a problem ever since. But that was our first meeting, was getting a major repair done on the front of the boat.
How did you get into this? Like welding boats or
I got into welding boats because of this guy.
I forced him into it, I guess.
I had welded on boats before, but I got into welding boats more so because they're aluminum, and aluminum's my specialty. I do a lot of aerospace aluminum for the aerospace community, and there aren't very many people that I know of around that will weld on a boat, and it's aluminum. And what aluminum, those machines are much more expensive welding apparatus than just the ones that will weld steel. So there's not many people around that'll do it. I'm willing to, but it comes with its difficulties, of course.
Wait. So aerospace. So by trade, what do you do then?
By trade, I'm an aerospace welder, which means I'm a TIG welder. Well, aerospace parts. So aerospace parts. So I'm contracted by machine shops who are contracted by major defense contractors like Raytheon, General Dynamics, Lockheed Martin, to make their parts. And then those companies that don't have in-house welders contract me to come in once they have so many parts. I put them on the calendar. I go in and weld up all their aluminum parts.
That's so freaking cool. That is awesome. Like, I always think like that, like, you know, like making things with wood and stuff, it's such a lost art to be able to do something like that. Like, and I don't know if Jared was here, he would be 100% hooting and hollering that we're sending too many kids to college just to get a worthless degree when there's so many trades out there.
I agree. And like I say, there's not many people out there. And I'm not saying there's no people out there that can't do it, but I'm just in a position being an independent contractor where I can take on doing repairs on someone's boat that a big company that's frying bigger fish. Hey, that's a good segue for this podcast, by the way.
Yeah.
That they're not going to be willing to take on something like that. It's not worth their time. where for me, it is worth my time. And I enjoy helping people that can't go into a large company and get help.
Mm-hmm. So then with that, you mentioned something about the different materials. Like, is aluminum, the aluminum that isn't on a boat, has it changed over the years? Has it, we talked earlier when this podcast began, like, you know, the Nokia phones, they don't make stuff like they used to. Is the quality of the aluminum gone down?
For boats, yeah. there's seven different series of aluminum, and then there's derivatives of those alloys as well. But boat aluminum is really one of the lower grades of aluminum out there. So, you know, to manufacture the total boat in the factory, that doesn't become a problem. But when we get to the repair part, it does become a problem, because aluminum itself has to be absolutely spotless clean to do a good weld on it, whether it's brand new material or older material. And it becomes problematic once it sits in water or any liquid. All metals will start to take on that substance over time, and you can't always grind it out or get to it. And a lot of times on a boat, if we're dealing with a crack, you know, you're going down the river and you may not know you have it, but you're creating a negative pressure behind that crack. So when you stop, that water and all the stuff in the water gets sucked into that hole and settles behind that material, which becomes an impurity, which once it's behind there, it's you hope you can weld that repair in that crack, and those impurities aren't going to be a problem. Sometimes they are, sometimes they're not.
So honestly, if you're building stuff for the Navy and NASA, like, a boat weld for you is probably pretty boring, honestly.
Not really. Well, because of what I just described to you, it's quite cumbersome. Just recently had a gentleman bring a boat over that has the, I don't want to call them pont. What are they on the back? The things that they're
stabilizing? Yeah, the pontoons on the back of the boats, the floats that you see in the back.
Flow pods. Yeah, flow pods,
right. So he had a little 3-inch crack from hitting a rock on the river and split it right where the two pieces came together on the back end of it, not close up to the boat. Well, the problem wasn't that it couldn't be welded. The problem was there was foam core inside. So trying to weld that up, that foam core starts to melt right into where you're welding, of course, where it's hot. Well, that's an impurity you just can't get out. And even if I cut open 2 inches on the top, 2 inches on the bottom, and try to dig that out, well, some of that's still going to be in that material there. So even if I try to weld a new piece on that, the part that I cut out, and then replace it, well, I have to remove so much of that material inside to get it away from the heat is the first problem. The second problem is that's what they call a closed vessel. There's no place for anything to get in or out. So once you start welding, once you get to the last, probably 1/8 inch, you superheated the air inside that closed container, and it has to be released somehow. So you'll go to weld that last piece and the hot air will blow right back at you and keep blowing that hole open and not close. So really what you have to do is weld up to that and then let it completely cool and then come back 15, 20 minutes later and just try to weld that last little piece up. And that's typically how that gets done, but that's very problematic.
What is easier for somebody to work on, you think, fiberglass or aluminum when it comes to boats?
I've worked with fiberglass. When it comes to a boat repair, I'd say fiberglass, from the standpoint that typically you can do a fiberglass repair from one side of the boat.
Oh, interesting.
With a crack, because it has to be clean, if I can't get to both sides of the material where that crack or that repair needs to be done, I don't need to weld on both sides, but I need to make sure both sides are as clean as they can be. So fiberglass would be my take on which would be easier.
That is really interesting, because growing up, and you would hear people talk, they were always like, oh, aluminum is just so much easier to repair. All you got to do is just weld it together and you're good to go. And I feel like that was based on a place of ignorance, because the way you described it, there is so much that goes into making sure the weld is perfect and that you get those impurities out and you attack it from both sides. And that blows my mind that you know, people like to abuse their aluminum boats because they think it'll be an easy fix, but you probably should take a little bit better care before you go yeeting over some rapids or something, because it's not going to be a quick fix.
No, it's not. Well, yeah, one, it's not going to be a quick fix because in my mind, I do try to educate people before they bring me their boat and let them know that, you know, what you see is 2 or 3 inches of a crack. Well, that's not 15 minutes worth of work. That's 4 or 5 hours worth of work for me just to get it clean enough to fix 15 minutes worth of work.
Yeah. What do you mean clean?
You know, when it clean means that it has to be completely bare metal down the alloy. So when someone brings me a boat, it normally will have a coating on it, paint job, plastic vinyl wrap on it, or from the inside, as this one gentleman had foam core inside, what needed to be fixed. So all of those are impurities. They have to be removed. They have to be stripped off mechanically first with sandpaper, wire wheel, and then you have to take a solvent like lacquer thinner, denatured alcohol, acetone, which is best, and that has to be stripped off. And that's how clean aluminum should be before repair is done properly.
That's freaking insane. Like, because I think it's funny when someone probably gives you a project and they want something done and it's like way more complicated than they think. It's like.
It is. And I try to be, I'm very honest and upfront about what I have to do. But as with most people, it feels like taking your car to the repair shop with a transmission job. You just have to trust the person isn't trying to like pull the wool over your eyes about really what has to be done. And they'd almost have to sit there and watch you do everything. And typically when I'm doing a boat repair, I send lots of little videos and pictures to my clients to let them know where I'm at and why it's taking this long to do a repair. And you're going to run into things like anything else that needs a repair that you didn't expect, you didn't see, you couldn't see. And until you get in there and find out, and there's a lot of things you could just patch panel and go over, but nobody wants the water resistance going down the river with a patch sticking on the bottom of their boat.
Well, what's a patch panel? That's a good thing. Like, what is a patch panel to somebody that doesn't know like me?
So if you have something on the bottom of the hull of your boat that it's got a crack. So instead of just trying to clean this up and weld that one spot, because you don't know what's behind it, you clean a bigger area and then you cut a panel to cover that. And you're basically putting a Band-Aid or a patch over it and you weld around that instead. And because you know all of this is nice and clean. But who wants that on the bottom of their boat with all of that resistance and drag trying to go up the river? Most people don't.
That's so fascinating because I really do feel like if you want to get into this stuff, you do need to eventually have some kind of working knowledge for more than one, so you can have a little bit of a handle on doing it yourself, but two, so you don't get screwed over when you take it to somebody. And that's regardless whether you're into boating or if you're into electronics or if you're into like cars, you need to have some kind of working knowledge. And when it comes to welding, I keep getting back to like, it's just such a lost art that most people don't have the working knowledge, just the basic understanding of what has to be done. And that's why jobs that you have are in such high demand right now.
Yeah. And for me, it not just the skill set, but the tools to do it. You know, that's another reason why it's so expensive to get a repair done. Like I said, those machines that do aluminum, mine isn't even the best of the best. It's a very nice one, but that was $7,000 just to get the machine that will do aluminum. And then the gas that has to run through it to protect the weld, that's $180 a bottle. And then the welding rod and all, just those things add up very quick for just a small, tiny repair. But cleaning is 80% of what I do to prep out what needs to get repaired with a weld.
That's insane. That's absolutely insane. Now, so is this the same gear that you use in your main job, or is that separate equipment? So you then went out and bought equipment so you could be able to do this boat repair work?
No, it's the exact same equipment. Same process of cleaning, prepping, same filler rods, same machine. There really isn't anything different. It really doesn't matter the alloy. there's only one or two aluminum alloys that are non-weldable. And far as I know, the boating industry doesn't use those two. But you know, you deal with anything that just sits in water, and especially if it's a saltwater vessel, which I had a gentleman bring me a very large pontoon boat that sits in the Chesapeake Bay and had leaks all on the bottom. And that was solely from salt, sitting in salt over the years. And once it's to that point, I can't really weld all those little pinholes. I literally have to make an enormous sheet to cover that, to where I can reach, you know, I should go like this and reach where the water level is at and past that, to where there's good, to where there's good material up top that has never sat in that salt water. And that's good material. Everything else is done corroded. So these huge patch panels have to be made to go underneath if they're going to salvage the boat.
So with that said, when it comes to boating in this area, like, what are the most common mess ups, screw ups? I don't know, accidents. I don't even know what you call it. Repairs. Let's go with that. The PC thing.
Most are hull damage, you know, hitting a rock, you know, hull damage, broken skegs off of lower units for people using the outboards out there.
Yeah, you didn't mention that. You can fix that stuff too.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's not aluminum, but you can fix it.
Yeah. Yeah. Correct. And typically the eye hook up front where they're pulling the boat back up on the trailer. And that's not from pulling up on the trailer, from what I hear from Mr. Greene here. It's more of they never tightened it down far enough once they got it up there, and it's bouncing, and they don't know it's bouncing on the trailer going down the road. So a lot of those.
I mean, it's amazing how much damage. I've just learned this over the years. Unfortunately, I had to learn it the hard way. How much damage your trailer does to your boat.
Oh, God, absolutely.
I would imagine since you have a glass boat, I would imagine that's probably the same. You've probably found that over the years, haven't you?
Yeah, and that's the whole other issue too. Is luckily your boat's a little lighter, so let's say if you get it on the trailer, you can still move it around, and that's a big issue when your boats get heavier and heavier. It's like with my big ass fiberglass, if it's not on the trailer right, I got to put it back in the drink and I got to readjust it. So if I don't have it tight on there, like you said, I'll create that pounding. My boat weighs over like 5,000 pounds plus. Yeah. Like there's no way in hell when it's out of the water that the winch is going to get it snug. And I think that's something interesting that goes into it's the subtle devils and the details. If you go with a heavier boat, there's pros and cons to that, whether it's aluminum or fiberglass, about getting it on the trailer and dealing with things like that. And also checking, you know, your paneling. It's very important because I ran into that issue where one of them rotted. The metal brace actually rotted away, and then all of a sudden you got a nice sharp thing going to want to puncture your fiberglass. So trailer care is so important. And again, the only person I knew that really did good trailer work was in Leesburg, because they did the trailers for like all the rich white folks in Middleburg and stuff. So they did great trailer work, but they're blindingly expensive, and there's just not a lot of people that do good trailer work anymore.
He's done work on my trailer too. And I have a galvanized steel trailer. And
so what you're saying is you just broken a lot of shit recently.
No, this is just over time. He's fixed stuff and made stuff better and reinforced it, and you know, from what it once was. And that's another thing. Galvanized steel. I can't believe what he was telling me. What is it? It becomes it's toxic if you don't strip the galvanization or whatever, however it's said.
If you're trying to do a welding repair on anything galvanized, and a lot of trailers have it on there, you have to remove the galvanization. Remember, all welding should be done with the bare alloy. So that galvanization, which is just a zinc coating, that's all it is, needs to be stripped off. And if you try to weld over it, one, you're destroying the material because that's an impurity, and it becomes a poisonous gas if you weld it and you're breathing it. That's a poisonous gas.
Dear God.
Yeah. Who would think that, right?
That's horrific.
I'm sure there's a lot of guys that, you know, they weld from time to time at home in their shop, and they probably do a fairly good job. But if they don't know that, they could be breathing poisonous gas trying to do that.
So with all this said, like, how much are you doing like boat wise right now with your main job? Since this is basically, I could be mistaken, this is your side hustle, correct? So how much work are you willing to take on?
It's all about, you know, time for people. I'll put as many people in the queue that can wait. That's really all I try to get to people as quick as I can is what I'm saying. So if I've got, you know, four or five in the queue on top of everything else I do with the aerospace community, if they can wait, I'll take them on.
What is a normal wait time? Again, I know we're, it really depends case by case basis, but let's go very broad spectrum.
Sure. Well, if it's a repair and not like a custom build console job, I could probably get somebody's boat back to them by the next fishing week. You know, drop it off Monday, come pick it up Friday. You know, as long as it doesn't rain, because I'm doing that work outside.
That makes sense. Gotcha.
So, yeah, if it's a custom build, you know, it might take me, you know, 2 weeks to build something like a rod locker for somebody from time to time. And I'm not saying I'm working 10 straight days and it's $2,000 to build a rod locker. That's just me fitting it in between everything else. So I can keep the cost down for people. I'm not trying to, you know, jack the price up to aerospace prices. Small repair, I can get it back to you by the end of the week. Something bigger than that, you know, I'll redeck a whole boat if someone wants to wait for it.
The one interesting thing in Jeff's email was about, let me just even find the correct wording here. A blueprint or a template of what you want it done. And I thought that was really interesting talking about detailed construction drawings, because I think in a perfect world, yes, I bet that helps. But I'm thinking of an average Joe that just bought an aluminum boat that works in accounting.
Yeah.
Like, how important is that for you to be able to do good work? Or is that just a nice little asset if you have it?
It's best if I have it. And it lets me know exactly what the client really wants. If they want a dialogue about it, that's great. If they just have an idea, I at least need to meet with them and go over exactly what they want. So, you know, if they want me to come up with the entire thing, that's great. It's just a matter of, like, I'm trying to give the client exactly what they're envisioning. And without that, I have to kind of guess, and I don't like guessing at that. So, Jeff here or myself, if we're paying somebody to build us something, we want to give them the most amount of information so we get what we want. What we don't want is to tell someone, if you can figure that out, that'd be great. And then we get it back and go, this isn't anything like I thought it was going to be. Nobody wants that. So that's where the drawing comes in from that aspect. And if they need me to come down and take measurements, do design work, I'm happy to do that. If they want to pay me to come out and sketch it out, I'll do all that too, from the get-go. So it is pretty important. And it's also important from the aspect that if they say, hey, we want this kind of console, but I have to look at your boat. Does your boat have all the right supports in the right spots to build what you're looking to do? It may not, but we may have to have that discussion.
I want to put a pin there because I definitely want to come back to the console thing. But now these drawings are only for like more detailed and labor intensive projects. So if you have a tear in your float pod, you're not going to need or going to want a detailed drawing of a 3-inch gash, correct?
No, that's correct. You know, okay. The drawings are more for people who want like a custom built something installed in their boat. For repairs, that's typically not needed.
Gotcha. Yeah, I just want to make sure we clarify for everyone listening at home that you're not going to get a freaking massive drawing for a 3-inch cut. No, that's fixy fixy. Yeah. Hey, some people can be insanely stupid online. I'm just telling you. You ever see a comment section? Like, there are some special ones out there.
Hey, Thomas, you have to remember, you asked him about the welding and the other stuff he does that he actually does for his fabrication business. But I mean, he works on, high-end cars, man. He fixes parts. The one brand name car that he works on is Ferrari.
Wow. So
yeah,
you got to tell me, like, there's got to be some stories of some incompetence when people go to you for an issue and you're like, there is no way. Do you understand what I actually have to do? Because that's how corporate is.
Well, yeah, that's well, especially working on high-end automobile parts. Most of those guys know that, you know, it needs to be clean. If it was bathed in oil, you got to cook it out and all this stuff like that. Recently, they really come to me, not just that industry. Most people come to me with stuff and think I'm David Copperfield, you know.
He had the railroad company call him and want him to build, what was it?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
That's, like CSX wanted him to build this.
Yeah. They wanted me to build these big climbing ladders that they can go up over where the railroad crossings are with the big lights, you know, with the big X with the blinking lights. Wanted me to build those out of aluminum, and because the ones they had broke, and aluminum, and this is good, we didn't mention this yet, aluminum is very susceptible to cracking in and of itself through vibration. So I was telling CSX, you need to make these out of steel. This is why they broke in the first place. When the railroad cars go by shaking and rattling, well, that's vibrating everything around it, including the aluminum ladders, which is why they were cracking. It's a David Copperfield thing occasionally where you have to tell people why this isn't a good idea to try to fix this in the first place. So
that begs an interesting question, because based on things that you said, that aluminum is usually not the best metal to use. There's different alloys now. We can get into the carbon, fiberglass, like all that stuff for, like, you know, the space industry and the military. But from a boating standpoint, if aluminum is the best to use, is there a proper thickness that you should look for? Because I know different manufacturers have different thicknesses of their hull. As a person that works with these substances, what should you be looking for in an aluminum boat when it comes to thickness?
I would like to see at least a hull made out of eighth inch. It'd be sturdy enough, and with the supports that run from left to right inside, that should be plenty strong enough. Now, obviously, depending on your boat and boat manufacturer, I've seen thinner than that. I've never seen thinner than 90 thousandths, which is just slightly under an eighth of an inch. And I guess maybe if you have a metal canoe, you might have something thinner than that. But bass boats and usually fishing boats have around 90 thousandths to an eighth of an inch, which is substantial with proper cross supports like they should have.
So if you wanted to, though, if you had all the money in the world and you could build a custom boat, because there are manufacturers that do this now, like, how thick would you make the hull if you had your druthers? Would it be like that 1/8 you're talking earlier?
Sure. Considering displacement and how deep you want, whether it was flat bottom, V bottom, I think I'd go with a shallow V bottom boat. I'd probably 3/16 of an inch on the hull.
Wow. And
that would, you know, and I would go a little wider than most bass boats. Most bass boats are about 4, 4.5 feet wide, sometimes 5. I might go a little wider because of the displacement of the boat itself, and relatively light rather than going with steel. And from an aspect of, if you're going to do repair, if you can rivet something, well, it's much easier to drill through a piece of aluminum than it is steel. If you want to put something, rivet something on, sometimes that's the way to go, is to
really do
a rivet and not a weld. We just redecked the middle of Jeff's boat, and we riveted that whole thing in there. We didn't weld it all in, but that is twofold. One, we didn't want to make it super permanent in there, because if something happens underneath on the hull, you can drill those rivets out, take your deck off, and get to it. That's super important for people to remember. That
I didn't even think of that.
If you're going to deck something on a boat, I'd rivet it. I wouldn't weld it completely shut, because if you ever need to get behind there, just drill the rivets out, and then you can put new rivets back on.
That's really brilliant. So perfect world, you have a combination of a welded hull with riveted accessories, so to speak, when it comes to the decking and things of that ilk.
Oh, sure. Like your framework underneath all of that decking would be a lot. It'd be a lot of welding in there. But once you start sheeting it with your sheets of aluminum, I personally would go with rivets because you can take it all off. If something gets damaged, gouged, you get a crack in that, or you just need to get behind it to get to electronics, steering components, any of that stuff, repairs. Easy to drill out and take it off.
I would be remiss if I didn't ask you this question. Vexus came out with this boat a couple of years ago, and they touted it as a hybrid, which was like a fiberglass shell encased in aluminum. I think you've seen this boat probably before. If not, I can whip out a picture real quick. It was their aluminum boat, where it's an aluminum boat, but then they just put fiberglass inside of it, so you had all the luxuries of it. And it had a lot of issues of it separating. That's been a big issue right now. And I thought you could maybe shed a little bit more light into that for some people at home, because I think that's very interesting. Like, why haven't people tried to do this more often, of having like the aluminum hull so you save money, but then you can encase everything inside in fiberglass so you get that nice luxury Ranger boat look. But apparently it's pretty hard to do.
Yeah, aluminum in and of itself is hard to get anything to stick to, including paints, vinyl wraps, anything. And I'll tell you why. Anybody's ever tried to polish aluminum by hand, you'll get your polish out and you'll start polishing and it starts to turn black and starts to look nice and shiny. Well, you can get an absolutely clean rag, go back to that same spot, get more polish, polish it, and it's going to be just as black in 5 seconds. Because like copper turns green to protect itself, aluminum will instantly start to build back up a scale on it. I mean, instantly. And that's what keeps anything trying to stick to aluminum, including fiberglass. So
that makes so much sense. Yeah. So like, this is the, these are the Vexus boats here.
Yeah. That's a pretty cool idea.
It's a cool idea, but then like they're having a huge issue right now on recalls, because if you look at the top here, all this is just fiberglass molding with everything put in. And so apparently this is just being like pulled out like a glove.
Wow.
And it's not sticking to the fiberglass. And I'm like, or to the aluminum. So I'm like, well, how the hell, it looks like it's bolted in there. So I was like, how does that work? That makes sense though.
Well, the other problem that I would have with this is like what I had with the float on the back of that other guy's boat. If this hull gets a big gash or a crack that's leaking, I'm screwed. There's no way I'm going to dig out all that a fiberglass and get a good weld in there. It's just not going to work.
That is absolutely the juice right there, guys, because I didn't even think of that. That's brilliant. Like something like this, you literally cannot fix, or it'd be a hell of a job to fix it.
No. And even if I was crazy enough to try to weld a crack like that, if the resin inside that fiberglass catches fire, that whole boat's gone.
Hey, you can just use flux tape. You've seen the commercials, right?
Does that stuff work?
No, it falls off the boat. I put it on there as a quick repair to finish a trip, and then have the boat fixed. And it's very temporary.
Yeah. Well, and another thing with this fiberglass, if somebody called me directly and described that to me, and I told them what I just told you, that I swear they would hang up and call me nuts because they don't understand my side of things. And I get that. But they say some people just, you'll call a contractor to do something and they sound nutty. And then you get off the phone and you say, oh, well, they just said that because they didn't want to take the job. I'll work on anything if it's doable, but I'm not going to take someone's money when I know it's already going to be problematic and it's not fixable.
Yeah, that's like so brilliant, because like the way you described it, and this is, and hopefully this is enlightening to a bunch of people that listen to the podcast and that have aluminum boats or willing to get into aluminum boats. The amount of work and how you need to go about fixing something, where if you get these fancy boats, you have to think about how easy it is. And then a side note here, we interviewed a person that actually has Falcon boats, which is a fiberglass boat, which is so interesting with him is the fact that He is actually a mechanic by trade before he made the boat. So every part, he said, this boat can be fixed cheaply because he was a mechanic. And so there's no digital boards. It's all rocker switches and stuff. And everything is cheap. And I was like, that is brilliant that you did that. And so I know if I got something like that, how to fix everything. And I'm piggybacking off this with the Jeff, did you just fall over? You okay?
No, I'm good, man.
Okay.
I'm good.
It's like the whole world just started shaking there. But I thought what that is, like, if you're buying But my thought with that is, if you're gonna buy an aluminum boat, same thing. You need to know, like, if I buy this, how do I fix it and what will that cost? Because if you buy something like that Vexus, where it's like it looks sleek as hell, but with what you just said, like, it'll cost you a pretty penny to fix the thing. That's something that you need to factor in when you make these boat purchases.
Absolutely. And really, it's about access for what I do. You know, if I can easily access the spot and get it clean, well, it's a whole lot cheaper because I'm spending a lot less time getting to those areas and prepping them for the weld repair. So I know, you know, going, you know, every boat's made different, and you know, people are going to rely a lot on the sales representative to answer those questions. And you know, is the sales representative really going to, is it going to skew it towards him just getting the sale, or is it really going to tell the potential purchaser, you know, what the deal is with possibly getting a repair done?
So I'd be remiss to ask you this about, do you deal with lithium technology at all in your work, or do you have people around you that deal with that stuff?
I deal with some of my clients deal with it, but I don't deal with it directly.
I was going to ask you, Jeff, you probably already asked this question. Like, what do you think about lithium batteries for different things? Cause I've, it's mixed in my mind about trying.
Well, to from what I understand about lithium batteries, and this is just what I've been told by other guides. I mean, I'm not a lithium battery guru or anything like that, but once the temperature gets below freezing, they don't charge well, if they charge at all. So if you fish throughout the wintertime, you know, in an area like we fish, where you can fish 365 days a year, but some nights are going to be below 32 degrees, and then during the day it'll be, you know, above freezing, your boat's not going to charge.
Gotcha. Yeah, because like I've been like, I think we talked about this when we went fishing together. Like, I want to make the switch, but it's like, it's a hell of a financial commitment to make in case they break or something like that.
Yeah, and the thing about those lithium batteries for someone like me is they sound great, right? They're a lot lighter. They're supposed to give you better performance. But what happens if one of your batteries goes bad? I can't just go to Walmart and buy a battery real quick and keep trucking along. I'm down. So I'd have to have either another set of lithium batteries available, or have lead acid batteries, marine batteries, being charged in my garage at all times.
Yeah, I honestly, in my opinion, what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to get just one, but it's going to be a little bit smaller, and its only reason for existence is charging my electronics. That's it.
Oh yeah.
I think that's where having that battery makes sense, where you just need extra juice for your phone, for your electronics, but then keep your cranking battery, keep your trolling motor the way it is.
Yeah, but I don't know much about them. I know some guys that refuse to get them, and some guys are all about them. So it's mixed reviews, I guess, like you're basically saying.
So I'm thinking what we should also do is probably do a live show at, if you want to do Berkeley Springs, if you both want to come to Berkeley Springs,
yeah,
and we can really pitch the whole, like, the aluminum boat thing. And we could do a Q&A on that too, and let people know, they can ask some of their questions. Cause I bet there's a lot of people that have some interesting questions about fixing boats. I think I'd be remiss. I think at the river panel, somebody asked about boat repairs specifically, about how to do all that. So I think there's a market for that. We could definitely, because again, two parts here. One, no one does this work anymore. And two, no one sells aluminum boats. It's so niche. Like, there's not a lot of places you can get jet boats. It's all near Susquehanna.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, yeah. So it makes it harder to get these questions asked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think something else. And then I guess the one other one would be on here, this list, the center bolt console. Because it's a yes. Will you create a complete center console for a client?
Oh, absolutely. If their boat will, or if their boat is set up to actually receive it with the supports in the right spot, or we can create the supports in the right spot, absolutely.
Is your goal with this to like retire and just do this, or what is like, what do you, where do you want this to end up?
For me, every job is about just, you know, this is going to sound very cliche. It's just getting the client what they want. You know, that's it. You know, I don't think I'm going to retire on doing boats alone, but I enjoy working with the people who can't get really, that you can't find other people who really will take on this type of work. And it's a joy for me to be able to say, well, I can do it. So if you've got the money and the time, let's do the project.
Yeah, good deal. Because we definitely need more people like you out there to do this. Especially, I think we need to bring more awareness, because I think the aluminum boat culture, the jet boat culture, it's slowly growing in this area. More people are going to get into it, especially the Shenandoah, the Upper Potomac become more popular and they get better. I've been a huge proprietor of this on the channel that like, it's a chicken or the egg thing. When I talk to the DWR or river keepers, like, well, we have to make the water quality better. It's like, yeah, but we just need bigger fish. The fish are bigger. You're going to get more people there. And then you have more money. I mean, that's this pure and simple. And I think people are starting to see slowly like, oh shit, I live in Ashburn and I have this really cool river I can go fish. I want a boat. And what ends up happening is no one knows how to fix these things because it is such a niche market. And so people like you are just in desperate need.
And, you know, and I'm happy to take all comers. And I was telling Jeff that there's probably dozens and dozens of people with their boats just sitting in their yards because they haven't been able to find anybody to fix them. They're just sitting, waiting to be fixed.
So if somebody wanted to get a hold of you, how would they do that?
They can either go to the website, McGowansWelding.com, or they can call me direct at 301-366-5656. I'll be happy to talk to you. I'll talk to you all day long about your project. Doesn't cost you a dime.
And then, guys, as always, a link in the episode description to all of Jeff's information and Jeff's two information, Jeff Green's information, Jeff one and two. All the information will be in the episode description. And then hopefully we'll get both of you guys at the Berkeley Fishing Show. This episode, of course, will air way before then. Don't worry about that. But then what we'll do, guys, if I can make this work, we'll have a Q&A at the Berkeley Springs episode. So if you have any questions about boat repair, please let me know in the comment section below, and I'll make sure we get that done.
Hey, real quick before we get a send off here, I was going to talk real quick about the river Potomac. All right. So on the Upper Potomac River, the two gauges a lot of people around here look at are the Point of Rocks gauge and the Edwards Ferry gauge. And the Edwards Ferry gauge is creeping up well over 5 feet right now. It's rising. And so is the Point of Rocks gauge. It's rising, which is a good thing, even in cold water, even if the water is colder than you would like, 36 degrees, you know, 37. That's starting to get cold. And what we were talking about earlier, these jerk baits, and if people are, kind of confused on what jerk baits, what brands to get, here are three brands. I've mentioned this before in my little, emailers that I send out, newsletters and, you know, Facebook and Instagram and stuff. There's three brands that you can look at, and, from most expensive to, least expensive, you can go with these 110 Junior Mega Bass right here. You can get these at Cabela's, Bass Pro, places like that. The Lucky Craft Lures, I sell these, the Pointer 78s, Pointer 100s, and Pointer 65s. These are all suspending jerk baits, though. You want suspending jerk baits in the wintertime. And then the least expensive, but they're still good. Arapolis, Husky Jerk, and then there's a couple other ones they make as well that are suspending.
Really?
Yeah. These
these things are killers, man. These baits catch big smallmouth bass. And, you know, popping them through the water, a couple pops and letting it sit, a couple pops, letting it sit, or just completely dead sticking them. I mean, people need to try some of these lures, and they're going to find success in the middle of the winter. And they're going to see some of the biggest smallmouth they've ever caught or ever even tangled with on the river.
If you are unable to have your jerkbait suspend perfectly, is there any hacking way that you can adjust that?
Well, not that I know of. There's certain baits. You can get certain jerkbaits that maybe that rise, you know, that rise slowly. You can put those little, have you ever seen those little lead weights that you can stick on lures?
Yeah, lead dots.
Yeah, those dots. And you can get certain jerkbaits to suspend if they want to rise. But if they're falling and they're supposed to be suspending jerkbaits, either they're cracked or they're not a suspending jerkbait.
Gotcha. Now, hooks. Do you change the hooks out at all?
You know, I don't. You some of them you probably should. I think Lucky Craft has really good hooks on theirs. I think Mega Bass leaves something on the table to be desired when it comes to their hooks, because they bend out pretty easy. But I mean, they're still good. And the thing about the Mega Bass lure is there's three hooks on it. I mean, you got nine opportunities on here
to
hook that fish in the face. You know what I mean? And the Rapalas have good hooks too. But if you want to, I think, what is that? VMC?
Mm-hmm.
VMC hooks. Those are a good hook to start with.
And then I'd be remiss if I didn't plug hooks that I like, which should be like the Aaron Martin finesse treble hook. Aaron Martin finesse treble hooks. I like those as well. I think both of our treble hooks, they're paper thin and they're very sticky. I like to say they're very tacky almost. Mm-hmm. Especially, and this is me going down the rabbit hole, guys, so brace yourself. I think that a bass's mouth in the wintertime is a lot harder because of that cold weather.
Yeah.
So you don't want a big freaking gaff shark hook. It's not going to puncture as easy. You want something that's really sticky sharp to be able to get in there and hold.
Yeah. No, you're exactly right. I should have brought that up. Yeah, they somehow, some way, it seems like their mouths get harder.
Yes.
Now, yes. I'm not a biologist. I can't explain it to you, but there's some truth to that. There's some real truth to that.
Because I heard Kevin Van Dam, and that's where this knowledge comes from. So, you know, I'll say it's my own. That when those fish in the summertime get super hot, their skin gets soft. And that's when you have those triple grips that the point actually, let me see, the point like faces inward more, almost like a hook. And that's why he developed that type of hook, is when those mouths are super soft, that's why that hook works so well, because it's caved in and it kind of sticks them in there. Because what will happen, allegedly, of course, when they start shaking, when they have more energy in the summertime, they make that hole bigger. And that's why you're going to want to go with a thicker hook that's bent in. And so I assume the reverse is true in the wintertime when those mouths are hard, that you want a very thin hook that can just get right in there.
Well, you know, and in the wintertime, these fish aren't, now, you know, you know, there's exceptions to every rule, but these fish aren't jumping out of the water. Mm-hmm. When you hook these smallmouth, they're digging and they're going down. They're easier to catch in cold water, meaning they're not going to come off as easy as they do. If you hooked a 5.5-pound smallmouth in the summertime, early in the morning, late in the evening, like on a topwater, he's coming out of the water 2, 3, 4 times. And you're just lucky if you land that fish.
You bring up a good question. Have you had a smallmouth jump in the wintertime?
Yeah, I have. I've seen them jump in 39-degree water.
Really?
Yeah, not real big ones. I guess the smaller ones, because they just don't know any better, I guess, you know. They're just young. But, and you know, they don't have that weight behind them.
Yeah, so that makes sense.
They try to throw the hook, but... you know, those smallmouths, obviously they could throw the hook underwater because their head shake is just so violent. And you know, it'd be interesting to find out how strong that head shake is, if you can compare it to something, you know.
Oh,
their head shake is incredible. It's probably harder than a largemouth.
It's so savage. Like their ability to shake and throw a hook. And that's something that you guys got to really think about. Like, an example is in that, I think it was in the Hidden Gems episode I did where I had one on a spybait. I only had one hook in them at first. And that's why I was bobbing and weaving the reel so much, because the smallmouth has the ability, they can just get so much weight, even those smaller ones with those head shakes, that what happens is the bait acts as a fulcrum point and they just shake the bait loose. And that's why you have to keep constant tension. And this is also why, on a side note, it's easier to fight fish in a boat than a kayak. Because in a boat, you can walk around the boat to keep tension. So if you're using a jerk bait or a crank bait or something, a treble hook, you can, in theory, walk around and keep perfect tension. If you're in a kayak, you can't. You're just stuck with your ass in a chair like you're sitting on a toilet. Yeah. So you have less ability to keep good point of contact with that fish. And so you really got to think about that when you make your casts, like what kind of situation you're going to be in for the hook set and to fight the animal that you're trying to get into the boat.
Yeah. No, they're something else, man. They're like Houdinis on a hook. Oh. It's incredible. We had one just real quick. It wasn't winter time, but guy hooked one this summer. It was like late August, early September. He hooked it on what I call a bug bait. What are they called underwater there, or under the rocks? I can't even think of the name.
Helgramites?
Helgramite. I lost the name. They it looks like a helgramite, right? And he hooks this thing. This thing is just an absolute beast of a smallmouth. And you know, a storm was coming in. It was getting ready to rain. And I think that's why this fish came out. You know, it was starting to get real cloudy, and the weather conditions were changing. Well, he hooks this thing, and this thing jumps three or four times, and I cringe every time this thing comes out of the water, because I mean it comes completely out of the water. He's bringing it to the boat. It's getting closer, and then it's almost like this fish at will. I have the net ready, and it's like this fish is like, not today. I'm done with you guys, and just throws the hook. I kid you not, Thomas, this fish is well over 5 pounds. Just throws the hook and is like, see you guys later, you losers, and just swims away, you know? Incredible.
Well, we will definitely get back out in the water once we get through this shitty period. I'll just say it. Once the summertime goes through. But guys, again, Jeff is the man. He basically owns the Upper Potomac. He really does in his area. I mean, besides that one crackhead that we saw, who else is out there?
I don't know what I'm going to hire him for, but I'm going to hire him for something. Maybe public relations or something. I could just have him boat around the river asking people if they have a gun in their boat.
Yeah. You put him on your good spots. He ain't going to fish. He might shoot some ducks, but he's scare everyone else away.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a hell of a story. Anyway, guys, again, thanks to both of you guys for coming on the show. Yeah. Again, guys, please like and subscribe to the channel. We are right now the fastest growing outdoor podcast show in the greater DMV metropolitan area. We are actually now charted nationally. We're in the top 150 podcasts in our genre, which is awesome. And we'll see you guys next time on Fishing the DMV. Bye.
You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your hosts, Thomas Ahrens and Jared Mounts. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.